jive and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the jive and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. I love Java, sweet and high. Whoops, Mr. Moto, I'm a coffee pie. Shoot me the pot and I'll pour me a shot. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. Oh, sleepy slug.
Hey, everybody. How's everybody doing this fun and wonderful hump day? I can tell I should have had more coffee before the show today. Let me get an injection there for a moment. Hey, this is Tom. In case you didn't know, you're listening to queerpublicradio.com and gaytalkradio.org. We're blessed so early in the new year with a wonderful and talented young man who's going to be speaking with us today, an award-winning concert violinist named Andrew Sords. Yeah, we're going to have a lot of fun speaking with him, and you can even call in and talk with him yourself. The phone number for that is going to be 301-TALK-GAY. 301-TALK-GAY. And we'll open up the phone lines a little bit. Give me a little time with him before you come jumping in. I'll let you know. You can even connect with us through Skype if you're overseas or somewhere. You want to call in and give him a hard time. It is Gay Talk Radio. Yes, our name on Skype is Gay Talk Radio. It's all stuck together like it's in one word. You can also go to our social website, queerpublicradio.com. There's a contact button up there. It's got all the information there where you can contact us from there as well. So, goodness gracious, let's listen to the rest of the Manhattan Transfer. Don't forget I'm in the chat on Queer Public Radio. Having fun now. Yeah, we got Andrew Sords with us today. He got his own website, you know. I mean, he's a big shot. So he's www.andrewsords.com. Check him out. And without further ado, goodness, let's give him the royal welcome. Hey, Andrew.
Hey, Tom, I love it. I think that's the first time I've had a royal welcome before.
Oh, no one's ever given you a fanfare?
I mean, that was you know, fit for a queen. That was fit for a queen.
Well, we try to, nothing but the best here, you know.
I love it. Star <What'd> treatment.
Oh, Andrew, it's our pleasure to have you. Our pleasure to have you today for sure. Oh, goodness gracious, I got all kinds of notes. I went and tried to find the trash on you, but I wasn't so lucky. You know, you're just too clean cut.
I'm squeaky clean. That's my Catholic upbringing.
Yeah, I know. I think you're better at hushing it all up. Shh, here's $10. Go shut up. I'll buy you a drink. You'll forget it all in the morning.
Oh, I'll give you my ex's phone numbers, and then you can get all the
drinks. Oh, my God. Whoa, wasn't that set up. So let's see now. Let me see what I got. All kinds of notes. So where are you right now?
I'm in Cleveland, Ohio. I'm going to Florida on Friday, but I live in Cleveland, so I make my base in the wintry 6 months of winter every year.
So you do a lot of flying then for the majority of these locations?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's about 6 months of the year that I'm, or more even, that I'm traveling. So I've gotten to know airports rather well.
Oh, goodness gracious. So let's see. So I noticed you had a lot of Ohio locations that you were playing at, so I figured. Mm-hmm. I figured that must be where his base is.
Well, that's important to me, to play in the Cleveland area as much as I can and play in Ohio, because this is, you know, where I grew up, and I'm so familiar with the area. I think it's important for me to be out there doing what I can here, as well as, you know, the exotic locations.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. So, let's see. You're going to be playing in Jacksonville, Florida this Saturday night, right? Yeah, mm-hmm. And it's going to be with you and a pianist, right?
Pianist Anita Pontremoli, who is just fabulous. I've been working with her now since I was 18, and we just have the best time together. We have the worst work ethic between us. We'll spend an afternoon rehearsing, but the afternoon includes coffee, gossip, and then finally get into the music. So it's a great time.
So is that the difference between because I saw a lot when I was researching you there, that I saw this term, concerti, with the I on the end. Is that like if there's only a few instruments, or?
Concerti. For instance, when I go play concerti, that's sort of the port for solo work with orchestra. So I do maybe 40% solo with orchestra, and then 40% recitals, and then the rest of the time is chamber music. So small ensembles, 2, 3, 4, 5 people.
Okay, so that has nothing to do that different putting the I on the end of the word concert. I'm missing the significance there.
No, it doesn't really have anything to do with the concert. It's just sort of a fancy expression for the repertoire.
Oh, okay. I was like, is that? Oh man, I was just, you know, in my untrained mind was trying to figure out. Okay, now what's that word? I mean, and I had a lot of that when I was looking up stuff about you.
That's funny. It's funny how some unique words come up with the searches.
Well,
I mean, you know, I'd rather sincerity than other words. So.
I mean, I'm half Italian, and I know Italians. There's a lot of Italians involved in classical music, you know.
Tons.
Yeah, right.
I'm very proud of the culture.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's a whole nother show. Andrew.
you get them started on Verdi and Puccini and pasta, and we're set for an afternoon.
I mean, even the pianist that you're playing with she studied in Milano, uh-huh. Right, in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
At the Giuseppe Verdi Conservatory. I hope I said that right.
Yes, you did.
My grandparents on my mother's side were immigrants from Italy, so if I didn't say that right, I'd probably be in trouble.
I think you nailed that one on the head.
Well, hey, somebody listening up there, look at that. But, yeah, let's see. So, and then you're going up to Toronto. Back up
yeah, I'm
to
going
the cold.
To, well, after Jacksonville, I'll be in New York for a few days. For interview and seeing some friends, and I'll be in Toronto in 2 weeks working with one of my favorite people in the world, Scott Seaton, and then I'm going to spend 2 weeks in Austin, Texas, followed by a week in the Eastern Caribbean island of Anguilla.
I saw that. I'm going Anguilla. Well, I'm just not even going to try to look that up. I'm just going to be lazy and ask him, and thank you for not making me ask.
The island of Anguilla, yes. Yes.
That sounds, I mean, just the name makes, ooh, you know.
Well, I don't know if remote's the right word, but I have to fly into St. Martin and then take a ferry over to Anguilla, so it's sort of an exotic experience, but the purpose of the trip, even though I'll probably spend, you know, significant time on the beach and shopping, but the purpose of the trip is to play a Western recital program in Anguilla, which I believe is a French nation, and a French-British nation, I'm sorry, and to listen to the music that their kids are studying, and then to have a week culminate in a recital. And I'm going to play some American music and some Belgian music. I play on a Belgian instrument. And just have a great time there for 5 days.
So let's get, you know, one more thing before we get to, like, some of the basic stuff that, of course, I'm sure you're really tired of hearing from people, but, what, oh, I lost it in my notes here. You were playing just before this last performance that you gave was in a church.
Yes, I played last night in the church, same program I'm playing this Saturday. So my Cleveland friends and family got to hear it before anybody else.
Ah, that's cool. So, I don't know, you know, so are you religious?
You know, I was raised Catholic. It's funny that you should ask that because I spend so much time in churches because of recitals or playing during the holidays. I am actually a big fan of religious music, the hymns, the Christmas carols. I don't practice it necessarily, but I think religion is akin to what people do in the bedroom. It's their business. What religion they want to practice is perfectly okay by me. I'm just not outspoken with religion.
Well, you're not outspoken about being gay either, because that's not on your website at all.
Yeah, that's not something that is, you know, front and center on the site. But I think my history with playing at Pride events in Cleveland and in Dallas, and then playing with LGBT orchestras, I mean, this is an area where I'm developing and trying to do as much as I can.
I was so blown away, I got to tell you, you know, kudos to you, because, you know, I know, as and I'm sure many know, you know, that there's these gay men's choruses all over the place, you know? We've all heard of the gay men's chorus, but until you came into my life, Andrew, I never knew there was a gay orchestra organizations.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
like,
there are.
I lost my gay card.
I'm sorry?
They took away my gay card for not knowing that. I got a feeling.
People in the States, the Minnesota Philharmonic was the first one, and I think that was founded in the early 90s, and I played with them a couple years ago, and I'll play with them this fall. And then there's one in the Atlanta Philharmonic, and I'll be there in March. And I played at Cleveland Pride in 2008. I actually opened the festival and was proud to be the first classical act to play at open a National Pride Festival. And I got a really good reception from that. And I think it was good for the community to see someone who wasn't so, I don't want to offend anybody, but who wasn't so stereotypical. I was out doing my own thing, but very happy with who I was. And I think they really enjoyed that.
Wow, kudos. Wow. That's a very powerful thing you did there.
Yeah.
That's totally awesome.
Especially in light of the recent gay suicides last fall with the bullying, I think it's very important, especially now. I mean, we're in 2011. It's a new decade. I don't know what generation they're even going to call this, Generation Z maybe, but especially with what's going on right now with the gay suicides and bullying and Don't Ask, Don't Tell being repealed, I think it's very important for anybody who has a voice that's unique, whether it's music or dance or, you know, Hollywood doing these blockbuster films like Brokeback Mountain was a start, to get out there and do their own thing and show that, you know, they can be special and being individual. For instance, the story of Tyler Clementi, who is the violinist from Rutgers, who jumped off the bridge when his roommate outed him, just really, for me, was such a heartbreaking story. And I'm getting emotional right now just talking about it. And things like that was an inspiration for me to get out there and do even more LGBT events than I already have been doing. And I'm going to go speak at a conference in Pittsburgh, hopefully play the Pride festivals again this summer, and just intertwine that with, you know, everything else that I'm doing.
Wow. You know, I never, to you just, again, I got another aha moment there. I had never made the connection about Tyler Clementi being a violinist.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So, goodness gracious. Well, I'm, you know, I'm glad to see you got the motivation, regardless of where it came from. It's an awesome thing when people, I mean, here you are, you got awards I can't even pronounce, you know, I mean. That's several of them.
Those awards, that's so funny, because whatever press information goes out, that's nice for the management company and whoever else wants to read it. But for me, the most important thing is, you know, when you get up there on stage and someone feels that whatever money they paid for the ticket, you know, why do people go see live concerts? They go see Beyonce or Beethoven or whomever to get away from their day, to get away from any arguments or their bills or whatever they have going on, and just to escape for an hour and a half or so. And I think, you know, if someone goes away and they come away from a concert being moved, then I did my job.
Yeah, I think classical music is an art. You know, an art is one of those kind of things that you grow an appreciation for, I think. And lots of people you got to slow down to have that kind of appreciation. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't go 100 miles an hour through life and have appreciation for art and everything. You know, it's one of those things you have to slow down. I mean, I like, when I listen to classical music, I like closing my eyes. So there's like, I don't have a visual, you know, muddiness of just listening to the pure beauty of the music, you know.
And a great difference between the visual arts and the performing arts is, as much as I appreciate the old Italian art, there's something static about it. You know, the Mona Lisa is never going to change, and you can go see her 50 times and appreciate different things about her every time, but my performance of the Beethoven Concerto is going to change every single night I play it. With the other people on stage with me, with a different audience in a different city. And that's one thing, too, that is so exciting to me, is you never know when you go on stage what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. You never know.
Right. That's, I think, you know, it's obvious you have a passion, because, I mean, I found online when you had performed, what was it, in January, I think, you performed in Idaho, and Felix Mendelssohn's violin concerto in E minor, was it?
Uh-huh.
And then someone, you talked to somebody and who interviewed you, and you were quoted as saying, "I've grown up with this piece and every life experience from school to all the relationships I've had. My perception of the piece changes all those different factors." I said, "If it didn't touch me or move me in some way, I wouldn't play it." So I think that speaks right there to your passion, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I hope now that at 25 I'm different than I was at 14, 16, 18. Different life experiences, and, you know, it's funny how dynamics and everything changes over time, and then your playing changes.
When did you start playing the violin?
When I was 7.
7?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I started with piano 2 years before, and piano was so much easier for me than the violin, because, you know, there's never an altitude note, there's never a scratchy note, and the neighbors aren't telling you to shut up about it. But then I went to the Interlochen Center for the Arts when I was 12, and I was not, you know, at the top of my class there, and I heard some of these players who were just outstanding musicians, and I thought to myself, why are they so good? And I thought, oh, they're practicing, and they're not just enjoying it, they're completely committed, and that sort of changed me.
Yeah, I think you have to, if you're going to, you know, do something and be well about it, or be good at it, I guess I should say, it's passion, I think, is, yeah, kind of an essential ingredient.
There's a great phrase that I like saying to students when questioning their commitment, and I don't teach regularly, but sometimes kids play for me, and I'll say, you know, and it's, I didn't originate this quote. I don't know where it's come from, but it's something like, if you take a plate of ham and eggs, the hen is involved and the pig is committed. And which do you want to be? And they look at me, I don't want to be the pig. I say, but you have to be the pig.
Someone's got to be the pig, huh?
Someone has to be the pig to make it.
Ha, 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 goodness. I think it's pretty awesome the way you travel around, because you're kind of an ambassador. I mean, even though, you know, you don't wear things on your sleeves, obviously you're not that kind of person. You know, it's like, you know, you're, yeah, and I think that, but people who see more, know more, and anyone who, you know, listens to Queer Public Radio or Gay Talk Radio now, he's going to know.
Yeah.
Has to be a different Andrew Sords. I can see some of your... That cannot be him.
That's not the sterile picture I see of him on this website.
Right. Oh, that's too awesome. I mean, there was a write-up for you in the San Gabriel Foothills Examiner by Laura Monteros. Did you see that write-up? I mean, kind of an announcement.
I don't know. I'm not sure what this is.
Oh, it just went on and on and on. I mean, I was just... Yeah, I think you were getting ready to perform there at the Crown City Symphony.
Los Angeles. Uh-huh.
In November 20th and 21st.
Mm-hmm.
And this lady just, I mean, obviously this is the kind of thing it was nice because I went to so many sites that seemed to have like this canned thing and the same thing over and over and over and over.
Yeah.
Boy, as marketing guys need to swap up the stuff once in a while, you know what I mean? But she wrote her own thing, and it was pretty cool, you know, because she just really glorified you. You know, I don't want to embarrass you, you know, I know if you, but that was one of those kind of things, you know.
Well, thank you, Laura, or whoever she is.
Yeah, Laura Monteros, writing for the San Gabriel Foothills Examiner paper before you performed there. They were like, she just... really, really glorified you. You know, they had talked how you had performed on four continents, and how you run the prestigious Festival de la Orquestra Sinfónica de las Americas competition.
Not that I know what you just said, but it sounds fancy.
yeah, it was like, so you're 25 now, right?
Yeah, I am.
Okay. Just making sure. Quarter of a century. Oh, man, it's all downhill from
there.
Don't
remind me.
I'm 50. I'm going to be 55 this year, so I got 30 years on you. So,
oh.
Yeah, I'm an old guy.
But, 55 is the new 25.
Oh, yeah, right.
Yes, it is.
Man, if I would have known, I would have worn my waders, Andrew, because it's getting deep.
That's funny.
Yeah. Let's see. So, I envy you for this Austin thing coming up. Your violin is a 1921, and I'll let you say, I got Augustine
Talisi. Yes.
Talisi.
My violin is from Brussels, Belgium, and when I was searching for instruments, I must have tried dozens. It was a long process, and what I would do is I would get these violins in from a couple of different cities. There was Chicago, there was Boston, and there are some from the Cleveland area, and I went into a nearby auditorium with my teachers, and they sat in the back, and I would play the same piece over and over and over and over and over again, and it came down to two different violins, this violin and a violin by the Italian maker Cavani. And I think it was a couple hundred years old. And, you know, it's a great fiddle. But this violin, it's not the easiest to play, but it's a little temperamental, but it's got a very sweet, very vocal quality to it. And, you know, it's like a life partner, you know. You have good days with it and bad days with it, but, you know, I never let it out of sight. It's like a third limb, a third arm, rather. So.
Hmm. You ever heard of the movie Electric Dreams?
I haven't.
Oh.
Sounds like something I need to add to my Netflix.
Nah, you probably wouldn't like it. It's old school stuff. But it has a part in it where this is this girl that plays the cello. And she has a part in it where she's getting on the elevator. The elevator is crowded. It's a very old cello. And the cello gets, as she put it, eaten by the elevator doors.
Well done.
Yeah, it crunched, you know.
Oh, God.
Yes, and this girl went into a meltdown. You know, I mean, she could, oh, she could never play again, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And this, the young man that's part of the story finally convinced her that the music came from her heart, that, sure, the instrument was in the formula, but that was not the only variable in the formula, that, that, you know, that she was more about the music than just the instrument. And so, anyway, I just...
It's a good message.
It was a wonderful, beautiful message. It really was.
Yeah. It's a good message.
And, you know, I just, for some reason, when I, you know, heard about your 96-year-old violin, and I'm going, oh, it, that's the first thing that came to my mind was that scene from that movie.
Yeah. I mean, it's amazing how durable these instruments are. I, one of my former teachers from Dallas is playing a Stradivarius from, like, 1707. And, you know, it's in mint condition. And it's amazing how these violins hold up.
Yeah, I mean, that, which that speaks to the workmanship to when involved in making it. I mean, wow.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. And it's like having a luxury car, though, that you need to take in all the time and get looked at and tweaked and, you know, fiddled with, no pun intended. And so that, that can get old really fast, but it's important. It's got to sound good.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting on, it even mentioned on this, I think it was on your site, that the type of strings that you use, the maker of the strings, and I was like, you know, kind of like the guys in the sports wearing the Nike hats and stuff, you know?
You know, it is like that. You'd be amazed at how many people are asking me what kinds of strings I have, and It was a long search. I was mixing and matching. You know, there's four strings on the violin, and I would have sometimes three different makers.
Really?
Strings. And it was very frustrating and uneven. And then finally, I was put in touch with this company in the Czech Republic, Slovakia. And they sent me a trial set of strings. And I think I was in New Hampshire at that time, and I had a broken string, and I had to put on a new set very close to a concert date, and I put these on, and they really worked with my particular violin, and so since then I've been using them exclusively, and we have a nice relationship.
And you get all the strings you want, huh?
All the strings I want. Yes, I do.
Got backup strings and backups for the backups. And
well, you know, you never know.
That's true, right? That's so cool. Oh, let's see. What else did I have? Well, let me give you a second here to just say anything you want to say.
Well, I'm glad that we're able to speak because, like I said, you know, promoting music in the LGBT community and everything, you know, it's 2011, people. It's time that we wake up and realize that culture and the arts and these beautiful aspects of life really enrich everyone who comes into contact with it. And that's why music education in the schools is so vital. And that's why attending concerts is so vital. And I feel very strongly about that.
Yeah. Clearly. Yeah, I think people, you know, it's always been, it seems to me it's always been kind of like a very too limited group, subset of society that supports the arts, you know. And I've never really, you know, I've never been that supportive myself, you know. I mean, I've only been to a few plays in my life and a couple concerts, and I, you know, but I've always been kind of a poor guy and that kind of stuff, you know. It's like out of, way out of my budget, so.
Well, I've noticed that at recent concerts, more so than when I was attending concerts with my mother in the 90s, Cleveland Orchestra, and it was all a certain demographic, I do believe that it's becoming hip and sophisticated to go to these concerts. And I see all these young people on dates or music students at my concerts, and I think it's great. I think it's awesome.
That
is. You find those tickets, people.
That's very awesome. Oh, I'm glad to see that. Because that's, young people. It's like that seems like an oxymoron.
and they love it. And you know what? I don't care what age they are. I had this one concert where in the first couple rows, there were students from the nearby school for the deaf. And each of these students had different levels of hearing loss. And I went down and spoke with them after the concert, and the teacher, they were all signing what I said to them. And the teacher said to me, "This girl here on the end is profoundly deaf. She can't hear anything, but the violin is her favorite instrument." And I don't know if she had ever seen a violin that at that proximity, but I put her hand on the scroll of my violin and started playing so that she could feel the vibrations. And she was beside herself, and she started crying. And that made me emotional, and I thought, someone who can't hear what I'm doing is still so moved by what's happening, then there is a purpose. There is a reason we're doing this. And there is a reason we spend all of those solitary hours working, practicing, missing flights, hours in the airports, so that people can experience that.
Oh, what a beautiful story. Yeah, I made my eyes watery just listening to that story. It takes a real man to cry. I'm here to tell you.
I'll tell you. You should see me during Desperate Housewives every Sunday night.
Andrew, are you on a schedule? Are you going to be having to run off pretty quick here?
Talk to me. What do you want to know? you have my hour, so.
Cool. Okay. Well, because I was kind of going to give you, we're at like the half hour mark here, just a little past, and I was going to let you take a little break, and I could play that piece that I captured off of your website, that.
Terrific.
Yeah, that is you. This performance you're going to do Saturday night, right? Isn't that what this is?
Yeah. Yeah, that's the next clip from that,
Yeah, it's the clip I got is about 3 minutes and 12 seconds. So if you want to take a little break, I can put that on. I can make me another cup of coffee, and we can maybe go to the little whatever, relieve our shelf room.
Well, thank you, Tom. Thank you.
Okay, we'll do that then. That's all right with you?
Yeah.
Then after that, we'll see if anyone wants to call in and say hello or anything. All right.
So
let's play this little piece here. This is on Andrew's website. It's at www.andrewswords. That's SORDS.com. AndrewSwords.com. And on his biography button there, you can hear the music here. And here's what I captured, and this will give Andrew and me just a moment to compose ourselves. Yeah, that's a better way to put it. We shall return. That was beautiful, I tell you.
That was a long time ago, I think.
That was a long time ago?
Yeah, 4 years ago, I believe. I think I know exactly what concert that was taken from with Anita again.
Wow.
It was nice. It was nice listening to that.
I enjoyed it. I know I was like, you know, I was thinking, because I wanted to pump up some of the violin parts, because the piano at some parts, you know, was so much louder, so, you know, it just plays better over the air, and I was thinking, ooh, I better not do that, or someone's going to get mad at me. It's like it's supposed to be like that, don't you? You know, because I played classical music as, I mean, I was trained. About 10 years of my childhood I spent, you know, with the weekly, the teacher would come over to the house, spend, mm-hmm. you know, 30 minutes or whatever with me, and you know, I would learn to read music and all that kind of stuff. And,
I still teach myself to read music sometimes.
Well, the kind of music you read is like that's a whole other world. Classical music can...
The funny thing is, the clip that you just played, the Franck Sonata, it's a movement from the Franck Violin Sonata, we played that last night. Same piano, same violin last night. And it's interesting to note the similarities and the differences, like we were discussing earlier, what changes over time and what, you know, what basic philosophies remain the same. So it was nice to listen to that. It didn't sound like we did it last evening, but it was nice to listen to.
Well, I, you know, the very first part I had to cut out a little bit, like the first 30 seconds of it, because there's somebody coughed or something like that, or they dropped something or whatever.
I love an asthmatic audience.
But I was like, wow. It was actually a pretty good recording, better for an open-air mic kind of thing, you know.
Uh-huh.
I was like, because that's a hard thing to capture, you know, because my brother plays the guitar, and I was showing him your picture and talking about you, and he had a few choice words, and I'll just sum it up by saying he's very jealous because you're, you know, he said he's a damn prodigy child. You know?
Well, I think prodigies apply more to 10-year-olds than 25-year-olds, but I think it's an equation. I think it's an equation for any musician out there who's doing it. I think, you know, you've got to have the parents who are willing to support you and drive you through those lessons, because, you know, I'm sure my mom had to make a lot of sacrifices with her time, taking lessons and weight and, you know, new instruments. And then it's the work of the musician, and then there's natural talent. And then there's a little bit of luck. I mean, people hear you at the right time, at the right place, and they want to help you and promote you, and then you see what happens from there.
Yeah, well, you left out the biggest part, or at least the most vocal part I heard from my family, was like, that song again? Haven't you got it right yet? What the hell?
I mean, there's always those times, you know, the funny thing is my parents and I will talk to no end about, oh, well, that could have been better, that could have been better, what the hell went wrong there? But, you know, it's at this point, it's the little things don't matter anymore. When you've got 60 concerts a year, the little things happen, and you just hope that the big picture...
There you go. Goodness gracious. Because the other is so stressful. You know,
yeah. I mean, it's like if you stress about every note, well, yeah, I spent 4 years of my life doing that in undergrad, and I'm not really interested in doing that anymore.
Yeah. Here's a man practically living out of a suitcase. Now you want him, why don't you just cut his wrist for him? You know, come on.
Exactly.
Cut us some slack, you know. That, you know. So anyway, yeah, that's because my brother still to this day, you know, I remember because I played after I stopped doing the classical piano. My mother just was pretty distraught, and she bought me an organ, you know, and it had like the drums in it and all this kind of, you know, more of a pop instrument, you know, and I kind of like that, you know, and I started playing more of the pop music, you know, stuff rather than classical music. And enjoyed it, the boogie woogie and all this other stuff, you know.
Well, every now and then I'll break out into some Lady Gaga on the violin.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Maybe some Beyonce every now and then.
Well, the being classically trained is it's almost like being in the military or something. I mean, the way I see it, how much did you, when you were back in those days, when you were, and you're still learning and et cetera, I mean, you probably spent, hours a day or at least an hour a day, I'm sure, religiously practicing.
Well, the funny thing is, my mom had no musical ear. The only thing she played was the radio. And so she would be downstairs cooking or doing whatever it was she was doing, and I would disappear up into my room and put on a violin CD. And I had the entire Hardy Boys collection. I love those little mystery novels. And I would put on this violin CD, crank up the volume, and read a Hardy Boys book cover to cover, and it'd take me, an hour and a half or something. And I would go downstairs, my mom would say, "I'm so proud of you for practicing. Go out and play." I mean, and I'm thinking to myself, I remember thinking at age 8 or age 9, don't you hear the piano in that room, too? There's no piano in my bedroom. What were you listening to? So that's how I got out of pursuit for a while. But now, I have to carve out hours in my day to practice around a flight or an interview or whatever it is. I have to tell myself, the phones went off and the computers went off, and from 4 until 6, I have to learn this program, because otherwise it wouldn't get done.
Right. I mean, it's not like, just because you played something once doesn't mean you're going to go be able to give a stellar performance on it again and again and again and again.
It's a lot like an athlete. You have to keep yourself in shape, and you have to keep yourself healthy and alert. Mm-hmm. I advocate Red Bull and naps and work and exercise.
Red Bull.
So, oh, yes.
You're not a coffee drinker, I take it?
Well, actually, I have venti white mocha in my left hand at the moment, so I am a little bit.
Little bit. Well, that's cool. So that's, I guess you got that. Did you get that from a Starbucks? I got to ask that question because Starbucks, Seattle Starbucks, they're kind of like stuck at the hip.
I was actually at the very first Starbucks when I was in Seattle. The first and last time I was in Seattle, I think 2005. And it was the first Starbucks at Pike's Place or the market area.
Yeah. Wow, good memory.
Mm-hmm. Going down there and it smells like fish, and there's all kinds of, headless pigs and headless fish and everything they're selling down at the market, and it was great. I remember it raining almost every day that I was there, but I walked all over Seattle, went to the art museum, Benner Royal Hall, Pike's Place Market area. Had a great time.
Yeah, that's kind of the wintry here is kind of a drizzle. The winter drizzles. That's kind of like the winter. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's, it takes a century to get out to Seattle, but once you're there, it's fun.
Well, they don't call it SeaTac for nothing, the airport, it's...
the Tacoma,
Seattle, Tacoma, it's like almost halfway between the two, so... Mm-hmm. It's not like it's rural, because, it's like, look, there's houses and buildings and everything, but you're not in Seattle.
I mean, it's a great area, and Seattle has the Seattle Symphony and the Baroque Orchestra and the Chamber Series, and you guys have a lot of culture going on out there.
They do. My sister-in-law is actually a member of the one of the arts kind of things. I don't remember if I think it's with the performing arts. Uh-huh. As far as the play acting and stuff, the plays and that kind of thing. She takes her little niece every year to go see the Nutcracker at Christmas, so.
Aww.
Yeah.
As cliche as the Nutcracker is, it really is great music.
Oh, yeah.
That's great music.
They don't call it classical for nothing. That's, those dummies.
That's true.
Okay, so let's see. So you studied... When did you say you got your violin? This 96-year-old violin you're playing now, 7 years ago?
This particular violin I got Oh, God, I don't remember. Yeah, 7 or 8 years ago.
Yeah. Wow. So, okay.
And it took me a couple of years, actually, to really get into it. I mean, I'm learning new things about it every day. I'm learning, you know, what it can, what kind of pressure it can take, and, you know, the volume coming out and different sweet spots versus different inconsistencies. So
it's pretty amazing, you know, that anyone, for me, you know, that anyone can even play a fretless instrument like that, you know, and be pitch perfect, you know. I'm like, how do they know?
You know, it's, you should see me during American Idol and all those singing shows when people are singing, and it's, you know, if you're not in tune, nobody wants to hear you. That's right. The most important thing about Western music is the pitch, right? It's an organized pitch. All these songs are organized, you know, via their pitch. Uh-huh. And so if they're out of tune, if these singers are out of tune, it's like, who wants to hear you? And so you got to give a lot of credit to Whitney Houston and Christina Aguilera and these singers who go out there and sing very well and they're prepared.
That's that, yeah, that's the key instrument right there. I mean, the key point is it's preparedness. I mean, you still, to this day, I mean, if you're not performing, you still practice? You have a daily practice session still to this day?
365 days a year, my friends.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. But, I mean, some days it's just 30 minutes of scales, and then you don't look at the violin the rest of the day. But there are some days where I get back from traveling, and I just want to be lazy because I've spent all day performing or being on a plane, and then, you know, you make a bowl of popcorn in your pajamas all day. But, and then other days, you know, it's just like... I like to think it's just like anyone else's job, but I guess it really isn't.
I got asked, and I'm sure I already know the answer to this. It's probably a silly question, but you don't have like a backup violin or anything, do you?
I actually don't.
No.
I don't.
Do some artists?
Yes. I don't know the frequency that they would use another instrument. I mean, it's very difficult swapping between violins. I remember one concert I did a number of years ago where I tried out a really fabulous violin that morning and then had a difficult time playing my own violin that afternoon in the concert.
Ooh, wow.
So it's like you gotta be careful when fiddling around.
Every time you say fiddle, I think of a hoedown, you know?
I know. You think of a Copeland, you know, what, beef jerky commercial.
Actually, I think more of that old series, Hee-Haw.
Oh, that's funny. There are some people who look at me and they're just aghast when I say, you know, I call it the fiddle. Where's my fiddle? Or here's the fiddle. And they're like, well, you don't play country music. That's not a fiddle.
Right.
I'm like, I can call this whatever I want.
Yeah, really. Well, you just so you can prove them wrong, you'll have to do a square dance someday, you know. Play the whole
down. It's funny, though. I mean, it's funny what the press will write sometimes. There was one thing I was doing where it said jazzy violin and this Andrew Sords coming to town, and I'm thinking, I don't know how to play jazz. I don't know the blues scale. I wouldn't know what to do if I had to improv. I'm not a jazzy violinist.
I think that's, you know, sometimes people, they just make honest mistakes. They don't, you know, they don't obviously.
Well, then there was the one reporter who went and said, Finn has 24. She said, I was 42. And yes, I did take offense to that.
Oh, she was dyslexic, the poor thing. You know, I could have been...
She was dating me back to the 60s.
I was thinking when I was reading, let's see, he was born and blah, blah, blah. When I quit, and I said, God, I could be his grandfather. <You know? laughs> I felt so old. So, I mean, this is it for you, right? This is your career. This is, you're going to be playing the violin the rest of your life, huh?
You know, I'm happy with it, and as long as I keep delivering and having a good time and moving people, I'm going to keep doing that. I mean, I think when I'm older, I would like to settle down and teach at the university and pass on things that I've learned, because I firmly believe that there is no better education than traveling and going out and seeing different walks of life and meeting different people and hearing their stories.
You're
right. In different parts of the country. I mean, I think I've been very blessed. I've seen, you know, extremely wealthy areas like Lake Tahoe and others. And then you see the rundown slums of San Juan, Puerto Rico, and it's just, it changes you. It changes you when you experience different things like that.
And I think you're right. I think everybody should experience that. That's something I think so many people take so much for granted, that they need to learn, hey, you know, that you're actually, you know, blessed to have the things that we have in this country, you know, when so many.
Oh, God, yes.
And then, you know, people get this, you know, lots of people get this feeling that, like, that's their right to have all these luxuries of life, you know. And I think that's just totally the wrong attitude to take, you know?
And, well, we're fortunate that we can live in a country where we can pursue whatever dream it is that we want, and, you know, if you don't take your work for granted, I mean, if I took myself for granted for one day, my talent, I wouldn't be playing at the same level, because you would never, it's always a constant battle trying to get better. And then whatever reward comes with that, that's great. But it's something that's always humbling, believe it or not, is the daily grind of doing an hour of scales and making sure that you're in tune every day.
Well, you know, you took the word out of my mouth. That was, you must have been reading my mind. We must have been, like, mentally connected there at that moment, because, you know, that's the one thing I noticed, you know, that you have is a humility and you're humble. And I think that speaks volumes. I think that's so, and I think it's necessary. I think the people that get a little fame and they get a little notoriety, or they got a lot of people, you know, applauding their efforts and I mean, when they let it go to their head and they become snooty about it, I guess would be a nice word. And it takes away from it, in my mm-hmm. mind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that
I completely agree. And you know what makes one person better than the other?
Mm-hmm.
Nothing.
Yeah, I think that's because that's the whole thing with we got division in the world. You know, where instead of joining together in some commonality, whether it be music or you know, performing arts on stage or just looking at a sunset, you know, or being in the forest and listening to the sounds of the nature or whatever.
And we live in the celebrity crazed culture with TMZ and Perez Hilton and the Real Housewives of fill in the blank. And yeah, I mean, all that stuff is interesting, or not interesting, but it can pique your interest, and yes, I watch The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, but that's not the real world. The Hiltons and the Lohans of the world are not the real world.
Oh, ain't that the truth? That's a whole nother show. Let's see. So, folks, you got to go to Andrew's website to check out what he's doing, and he's right, you know, that we all need to learn the appreciation of the arts, you know. It's always kind of interesting to me, you know, the hypocrisies that can be pointed out within society, and I think that, you know, what you do is one of them, as far as people not appreciating it. For, I mean, people will bring up 1,000-year-old text from the Bible and stuff, but they won't go listen to thousands of year old music. Come on, give me a break.
Exactly. Preach it.
You know,
I love it.
People got their priorities backwards.
Mm-hmm. So true.
Because the music is really, especially this kind of music, and just from listening to that one piece, I was so glad we were able to put a little piece of your music out, because that instrument you play is in a world by itself, the violin, I think.
Well, thank you, Tom. Thank you.
It speaks. A violin speaks a language of itself, and like your little story about the little girl there, you know, that was deaf, just feeling the vibrations of the music. Oh. I mean, for those of us that can actually hear it, you know, it's even more so. I tell you, when I close my eyes and I listen to a performer such as yourself, it's just, like you say, it's every time you play, it's different.
And you're very sweet. Yeah. I'm leaving you and family tickets next time I'm out there.
Well, I just think, you know, it's something. I'm hard of hearing, so, you know, concerts really aren't. I mean, I'm deaf in one ear and like 60% in the other. So unless I got some kind of hearing aids or, you know, headset. That's why the computer's so good for me. But Andrew, I won't take no more of your time. I just will do what I can to get the word out, because I think that's folks, that was Andrew's purpose for coming here. I was trying to awaken a little more interest in the classical music arts.
Thank you.
Yeah, Andrew, I think it's thank you. Thank you. I mean, you're devoting your life to something that's on the fringe there, and I think it's awesome to see a young face there in that, and I think that's going to make a huge difference, and I think many people might realize that, and hopefully it'll happen. Great things will happen for you because of that, you know?
Well, I appreciate that, Tom. Thank you.
Thanks for being with me, Andrew, and all the best to you and yours, and get down to Florida where it's nice and warm. You can go outside, you know?
I'll write to you from the beach on Friday.
Okay. Oh, how rude. Have a good time, Andrew, and thanks for spending some time
with me. Thank you so
much, Tom. Goodbye, bye. And that was Andrew Sords, www.andrewsords.com, a wonderful, wonderful and accomplished violinist. Oh, I'm very honored to have had him here on Queer Public Radio, Gay Talk Radio. Of course, he is an out and proud gay man, but as you heard, it's not something he wears on his sleeve, you know. But he doesn't deny it as well, you know. I think that's important, you know. Some people aren't like me, you know, they don't have to be all in your face all the time. <You know>? I want to thank you for spending some time with us on queerpublicradio.com and gaytalkradio.org. With that, I will leave you and remind everybody that we're all one human family. You know, how can you listen to the music there that we heard, that little piece earlier, that violin that Andrew just plays, you know, in such a way that you can't be somehow moved emotionally, and that it actually, you know, speaks the language of love, people. Music, that's what it's all about, and it allows you to go places within yourself. That's all music. That's why music is so popular, you know. All the best to you and yours. We'll see you next time. Remember, we're all one human family. We're all brothers and sisters. Let's try to love one another, huh? We'll see you. Bye.
I love you, and you, and you. Oh, and you too. And don't forget him. I love her, and him, and her, and him, and him, and her. I love you all.
Adios. Have a nice trip. Bon voyage. Farewell to thee.
We'll leave the light on for you.